JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for June the 24th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar continued trading lower against all but one of its major peers on Wednesday and during the Asian session Thursday. It gained only against the Japanese yen, while it lost the most ground versus the Kiwi, the Aussie, and the British pound. The continuous weakening of the US dollar and the Japanese yen, combined with the strengthening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that financial markets continue trading in a risk-on fashion yesterday and today in Asia. However, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that EU bourses closed well in the red, and sentiment was somewhat improved during the US session, but still the Dow Jones and the S&P 500 finished their session lower. Only Nasdaq gained somewhat. Appetite was somewhat mixed during the Asian session, today. European shares drifted south yesterday, with major indices losing around 1% each, despite the bloc's preliminary PMIs for June coming in better than expected. The composite index rose to a 15-year high as the easing of lockdown measures unleashed the pent-up demand, but also led to surging price pressures, and that may have been the reason why equities pulled back. However, with the ECB staying adamant that it's not time to consider withdrawing monetary policy support yet, we don't expect this to lead to a trend reversal. We believe that this could be just a corrective phase, but bearing in mind that the Fed has already signaled that it is considering raising interest rates in 2023, with some officials even expressing desire for this to happen next year, we prefer to maintain a cautious stance with regards to the broader market sentiment. Appetite, although somewhat improved, remained soft during the US session as well, perhaps following remarks by Atlanta Fed President Raphael Bostic and Fed Board Governor Michelle Bowman, who said that while they largely agree that the recent surge in inflation is likely to prove to be temporary, they also added that it may take longer than anticipated for it to fade. Bostic also said that with growth surging to an estimate of 7% this year and inflation well above the Fed's 2% objective, interest rates will need to rise in late 2022. So following recent hawkish remarks by Dallas Fed President Robert Kaplan and St. Louis President James Bullard, Bostic is another member joining the camp of those believing that interest rates should start rising earlier, and that's why investors started worrying again, despite Fed Chief Powell and New York Fed President Williams expressing a different opinion. That's why we prefer to stay somewhat neutral, despite Nasdaq hitting a fresh record. We will stick to our guns until we have a better picture of when does the majority of Fed officials want to start pushing the hike button. Now, as for today, market participants are likely to shift their attention to the UK and the Bank of England monetary policy decision. When they last met, British policymakers kept interest rates unchanged, but they proceeded with a technical change in which the pace of weekly bond purchases slowed down. That said, they reaffirmed that as measured by the target stock of asset purchases, the stance remains unchanged, adding that the quantitative easing slowdown is not a material change and that they are ready to reverse it if deemed necessary. With regards With regards to their economic projections, they expected the UK economy to recover to pre-pandemic levels over the course of the year, while on the inflation front, they said that it may rise above 2% towards the end of the year, but this is likely to be due to transitory effects, and thus the rise may prove to be temporary. Given that this is not a Super Thursday, where we get updated economic projections in a press conference by Governor Bailey, we don't expect officials to proceed with any change at this gathering. We believe that they may prefer to wait for the August meeting to announce any further slowdown in bond purchases. However, it would be interesting to hear their opinion on the inflation and growth outlooks following the recent strong CPI and GDP data. A more optimistic language could be interpreted as a sign that they are getting closer in slowing further their purchases, which could support the British pound somewhat. Now, as for the rest of today's events, besides the Bank of England decision, we also have the German IFO survey for June, the final US GDP for the first quarter, and the US initial jobless claims for last week. All three of the IFO indices are forecast to have risen somewhat, while the final US GDP is expected to confirm its second estimate of 6.4%. Initial jobless claims are forecast to have declined to 380,000 from 412,000 the week before. We also have three speakers on today's agenda, and those are ECB Executive Board Member Fabio Panetta and Executive Board Member Isabel Schnabel, as well as New York Fed President John Williams. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.